And welcome to another episode of Safer Neighborhoods for Stronger Communities. I'm your host, Dave Shallcross from the Pennsylvania Crime Prevention Officers Association. Tonight, we're going to have a discussion on school bus safety. It's at back to school time. And my guest this afternoon is Mr. John Arty. John, welcome.
Thanks, Dave. Thanks,
John, why don't you tell the viewers a little bit about your background?
For the last 14 years, I've served as the assistant principal at Exeter Junior High, total 40 years in education, and
wow.
Just recently retired last month and was asked to come in and speak on school bus safety, and I feel fairly comfortable talking about that topic.
Well, I don't know, 40 years of school experience, John, you're probably an expert.
Not an expert, but hopefully we'll be able to divulge some information that will help some people out there.
And I'm sure we will. And it's all about our parents and our grandparents and other custodians of children in out of Berks County in the community, making sure that they're sharing this information with the children in their household, kids that are going to be attending school again this year. Yeah, we want to make sure everyone's safe, and that's the goal of this whole show, right? It's all about safety, crime prevention, and a better quality of life. So today we're going to address school bus safety for the elementary grade, mostly, and of course, you know, even some of the same tips go all the way through to high school, but we really want to focus on those little guys, making sure they understand some of the basic safety tips that we have to share. So with that, we're going to go to our slides and check out some of these points, John, and we're going to get through as many as we can to share with the audience, and hopefully they'll be able to see and understand exactly what we're talking about when it comes to back to school time. Every child needs to be instructed on how to safely ride the bus. And I see we have a little bit of technical difficulty, so we'll get to the slides. But John, tell me, in your experience over the 40 years of being involved in the school district, do we hear often that there is concerns of parents about safety on the school bus and activity, what's going on the bus?
I think from my experience, Dave, the safety issues aren't such a crying need from the parents so much as the harassment and bullying from kids to kids.
Ooh,
on the bus.
That's right.
More of an issue, I think, than the overall safety. And I'm sure that comes into play at times, but it may vary. My experience is related to mostly secondary schools.
Certainly.
And not the primary level. Maybe they have a different obstacles to face, but I'm sure they have the bullying issues on the bus.
Yeah.
At the elementary level as well.
Well, you know, I recall back in the day of history, I'm going back to the dinosaurs, when I rode the school bus, at one point I was actually a school bus safety. It was mm-hmm. the AAA Automobile Club program where they had students assigned to help and assist the other kids within the school on the bus and whatnot. Is the school safety program something that's still active today?
I'm not familiar with that, and I know what you're talking about because we're...
I'm ancient, right?
Yeah, and I'm older than you, but I remember that we had safeties as crossing guards when
exactly.
I was in elementary school.
Yep, right.
And you'd wear the little yellow
sash
mm-hmm. on, and you'd probably have a handful of them within a couple blocks of each school, and they would help the students cross major intersections or anywhere where there was issues or a problem, and certainly was helpful. Now you don't see that anymore.
Certainly. Yeah, it's a shame, but because I thought it was helpful to have somebody on the bus who had a role to then help the peers on the bus, the other students, and be a role model. You know, proper behavior is reflected often when you see other students that are rewarded for acting properly and mm-hmm. doing the right thing and watching out. And that would eliminate some of these issues. If there was a child being harassed or bullied, the school safety on the bus could actually step up and put a stop to it, ask them to sit down, remain seated, behave. And if it continued, they would be a witness and mm-hmm. report on behalf of the student who's being victimized.
Mm-hmm.
It's a shame we don't have that. But today, what are we doing to help curtail that kind of action on the school bus?
One of the major means of prevention, Dave, is the video tape. Cameras on the buses.
Excellent.
And this is going back and forth. You know, initially there was audio and visual. Then it just went to visual. Now we have the audio and visual back.
Back, right.
Which I think is important to get both.
It is. I think that tells the whole story.
Right.
Right.
And so those, I know in the district that I was at, we had cameras on all the buses, and, you know, film doesn't lie.
Right.
So that was a big means of prevention, and was a big help to keep the kids safe and comfortable in the, on the bus.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, when you know that there's going to be a camera and that your actions are being recorded and that the school can come back and look at it, that also is preventative in its own nature. Not only is it recording and it is a an item to reflect back on and a resource to see what was occurring, but it also is preventative. When that student looks up and sees the camera right there mounted on the bus, maybe that will curtail some of that action.
Absolutely, and it's certainly not 100% foolproof, but it is a huge help to not only the bus driver, administrators, parents, teachers,
right,
and students among themselves. So it's a win-win for everybody, and money well spent, regardless of what district you're in or coming from. I think it's critical in today's day and age.
Absolutely, and when it comes to the bus driver, do we have, for the elementary and younger kids, I don't know if you're aware or not, but is there some type of chaperones or other aides to the bus driver that ride the bus still? Is that still occurring?
There is not, unless there's special needs students,
okay,
that require an aide based on their IEP.
Right.
To answer your questions, every now and then you may see, but that aide is on the bus strictly for that student,
not for the whole bus. So all that responsibility is dropped on the bus driver, on that person's...
Exactly. And I found that to be really unfair to the driver, because as we all know as adults, if you're in a car with three or four elementary school kids, and they're not being bad, they're just all amped up and they're screaming
they're
and yelling and they're being
kids.
Take that times, you know, 15 or 20. Now you got 40, 50 kids on the bus, and that bus driver has their major responsibility is to get these kids from point A to point B safely.
Absolutely.
And I've sat down with parents and students alike that if you picture yourself as a bus driver, put yourself in their shoes, and as soon as you look up in the rearview mirror because of some things that are going on behind you, what's wrong with that?
Right. Your attention's off the road.
Attention's off the road. And, you know, people buy into that. And so the driver's not there to babysit or, deal with discipline issues on the bus. They're there to get those kids
safe,
from point A to point B safely.
Yeah, and I think that maybe school districts should look at that and realize that it's a lot of responsibility on the bus driver. The bus driver does have that main focus of the roadway and the safe transportation of the children to also be the disciplinarian, so to say, for lack of a better term, on the bus. That's an awful lot of responsibility, and it's very distracting.
It is.
So maybe our parents could help out by instructing the children prior to getting on the bus, prior to the start of school, and remind them throughout the year about proper behavior.
Absolutely, and that's a good point, Dave. I think the parents, and most school districts, they have information on the website. And every school district's pretty much the same. We've got the slides here that are just basic information, tips for the parents and the students. So if the parents are proactive and get out in front of that and talk to their kids before getting on the bus beginning of the year, that's a huge help.
Yeah, I mean, some of the basic tips are very basic. If we could talk about staying seated, I mean, that's probably a great thing. If we can keep that child in that seat, they're less likely to become injured. Keep their feet in backpacks, books, etc., out of the aisle way, so no one trips and becomes injured.
Right.
And not to be turning around in the seat up on their knees, things of that nature. The bus stops short, there's a quick reaction from the driver, a child could get injured.
That's a good point. That happens more times than parents, I think, are led to believe. Because kids can be easily distracted.
Oh,
you know,
my gosh,
they're social. They're being kids.
They're being kids.
If there's someone behind them and they want to talk or show something on their electronic device or whatever, it's natural for a kid to turn around and engage in conversation.
Absolutely is. You know, and keeping their face up against the glass or out the window is extremely dangerous. Extremely dangerous. You know, these are things, again, that not only does the school reinforce, but again, I think it starts at home.
It does, and every school district has those rules, and I'm sure the driver goes through the rules and the guidelines with the kids on the bus the first day or the first week of school. I know in our district, we go over those procedures at school. So you're right. If the kids hear it from the driver, the school personnel, and their parents, hopefully that'll deter them from getting involved in those situations that compromises their safety on the bus.
You can't get good information often enough, right? So if it's reinforced at home, I think that's going to add another dimension to the importance of that to the child to understand that, hey, this isn't just a school rule. This is my parents care about me, and this is about my safety and the safety of the other students, again, on the bus, riding the bus. And you know, you just can't reinforce it enough that proper behavior leads to good safety habits. You know, horseplay and fighting on the bus, screaming and yelling distracts the driver. Mm-hmm. And of course, with bullying comes fighting, right?
Yes.
Keeping your hands to yourself, again, at all times, not just on the bus, right,
that's
John?
Right.
Throughout the day in the school, that would be a great thing to reinforce at home.
Absolutely. That's one of the big ones, especially for younger kids. Most of the time, by the time students get to high school, they've figured that out. But
right.
I think K through eighth grade, there's a lot of hands-on. The kids just feel the need to have their hands on somebody else for whatever reason.
And they're developing in that time frame, and they have changes in their social and their personal lives that I think that they sometimes just forget.
They
need that reinforcement, don't you think?
They do. And one thing I talk to parents a lot about, and students, is that that part of their brain, part of the kid's brain at that age, is not fully developed in the cerebral cortex, which controls your ability to make decisions and your impulsivity. So it's not fully developed, so they are going to make bad decisions at times.
Sure.
I've had teachers over the years always ask me, you know, John, why did he do that? Why did she do that? Well, that's why, because part of the brain that controls your impulsivity isn't fully developed.
Not until at least 25, and in some cases, you know, I worked in law enforcement a long time. Sometimes it doesn't work at all.
Come at all.
35.
That's right.
So,
yeah.
We have to make sure that our kids understand the rules and realize that it is for their safety, and that it's very important. You know, we got to be safe not only on the bus, but what about, John, the bus stop? What do we think about that?
Yeah, that's another good point, Dave. I think a lot of parents, maybe some parents, don't realize that if your child engages in a fight at a bus stop, that's just like if he were or she were to get into a fight in a hallway at one of the buildings that they are enrolled at.
So the school policy extends to the bus stops and the bus, correct?
Yes. To and from school, regardless if a child is walking to school, getting a bus to school, those school policies adhere regardless. To and from school every single day, and we make sure that that information is disseminated to our parents and our students as well.
Right, back to school nights.
Yes.
And again, at the stop, you know, horseplay, running, and stay out of the street. Oh my gosh, I hear way too often when a child's struck by a vehicle near a bus stop because of horseplay. They want to get that energy out, and I understand that, but it is so dangerous when you're close to a roadway. Now, again, in my neighborhood at the time, I remember we had a large bus stop. There was probably 30, 40 kids at a bus stop.
Wow.
Now, in some of our more rural communities, you may have a single bus, single child, rather, waiting for the bus at the end of their own driveway.
Right.
We were in the middle of the neighborhood, right? So I'm sure it's different for everybody if you're in the city, if you're out in the countryside. Whatever your bus stop is and however formatted it is, it's still important not to be running into the street, not to be screaming and yelling and disturbing the neighbors around you. And of course, don't speak with strangers and reinforce that to the children. Stranger danger, that's every time, every place, online, at home, at school, and waiting on the bus.
Yeah, and one of the things that came to mind, Dave, as you were talking about that, is I see a lot more parents out keeping either walking their child to the bus stop until they get on, or they're in a car parked at that intersection
nearby
until they get on.
That's great.
And I think, you know, when I was growing up, you didn't see as much of that. It was just, you know, go to the bus stop, get on the bus, and you're good to go. And I think with everything that's going on in our society today, I see more parents doing that. And I tip my hat to the parents that do that.
Absolutely, yes. And I know some of our local law enforcement agencies have started a program where they do bus stop checks. So they'll have the patrol officer in the community make sure if it's early preschool or afternoon, post-school time when the buses are going to be coming and going, they ask the patrol officers to actually stop by, perhaps get out of the car, greet the kids a little bit, little officer-friendly action. Let them know that the officer is nearby, the officer is going to be checking the bus stop remotely, and come by as often as possible just to have that presence of the police. And not only is it going to impress the children to behave, but it'll also hopefully deter anyone who's looking to harm a child by trying to stop by at the bus stop and lure a child out to a car.
Yeah, that's a good point. And I know in our school district, we're fortunate to have Exeter Police right down the street. I know there's some school districts in Berks County who are in the outlying areas, and they rely on the state police because they don't have a local police.
Right, troopers.
Exactly. They rely on the state troopers. And with us, the police officers in Exeter are fantastic. They will come into our buildings and just be a presence. And like you mentioned, they want to make sure their face is seen, and the teachers, the administrators, the students, they know that they're coming in the building just to check, make sure everything's okay, and show their face.
And it also helps the police department, because what it does is it makes the officer more familiar with the surrounding area of the school, inside and out. The officer, if he has to respond, God forbid, to some type of an emergency at the school, he's going to be familiar. He's going to know where the office is. He's going to know where the gymnasium is, know where the auditorium is. So it's a plus on both sides of that, John.
It is. And I remember meeting with the chief of police in Exeter a few years ago, and we had him and a handful of his officers come in and give us some feedback. What can we do different? You know, why is this door open? Why is this one locked? You might want to consider putting the kids here during a lockdown. And we make sure there's a great relationship in our district with the Exeter Police. And it made me feel much more comfortable and confident knowing those guys were right down the street and had our back.
Well, you know, it's a partnership. It's a team effort. The police need the community. The police need our leaders in our school districts and our townships and boroughs. Everyone plays a role in safety. So it's great that Exeter is participating with the school district, and those school assessments are excellent. It's a great way to button things up that maybe you overlooked, and you're not trained to know all those type of things. That's what the police, that's what they're there for. You're trained to educate the children, keep them safe as well, and we're all in it together. And I always like to remind our parents, you also play a role in that safety factor. You are part of the solution by being a participant with your child and engaging with the school. Make sure you attend students back to school night with the parents. Make sure you attend conferences with the teachers and participate. If you have a question, contact the school. Don't gripe about it over coffee with your neighbor. Go to the school and ask for an appointment, right? Let's find out how we can solve problems together.
Yeah, thanks for that plug, Dave, because that's I think the communication piece is important. And if you do have a question or a concern, call a school official and sit down and have a conversation. And that's the way to go about it.
Absolutely. And I know a lot of schools are having a huge problem with bullying. Bullying is just one of those episodes that we hear about over and over again. And in some school districts, it's totally out of control, John, and we know that. And I know everyone's doing their best, but we need to do more. We need to make sure that we reinforce the fact that we do not tolerate anyone treating other people poorly for any reason. We need to make sure that children know how to report the bullying issues, who to report to, and most importantly, I believe, is that we have to help them with coping skills. If you have been bullied, that's not the end of your life. That's not the biggest problem you're ever going to face. We know that we can help kids get past that. And John, what are your thoughts about bullying information for parents and on the bus, to and from school, and of course, in the school?
I think the most important piece here, Dave, is that the kids do report that to some adult. Sometimes the kids may not feel comfortable talking to a teacher or an administrator. Talk to your parent, or vice versa. As the kids get older, they tend not to divulge a lot to their parents.
True.
And seek out a teacher that you feel comfortable with, a school counselor, an administrator, some adult in the building, and make sure that they're aware of it. from the standpoint of other kids on the bus, you want to be an upstander. And
exactly.
that's a term we use to describe a student who's standing up for another student. If you see another student getting picked on, being bullied or harassed, say something. If you don't feel comfortable saying something, you yourself should report that to your parent or a school official.
And John, just to clarify, we don't expect other students to get involved physically in any way. What we're talking about is being there as a witness, being there as support, mm-hmm. and speaking up, verbally telling the bully that it's not going to be tolerated and we expect you to stop your behavior.
Right. That person, everybody's different. Sometimes a student will feel comfortable saying something to the people that are harassing and bullying the victim. And if not, they'll go and say something to an adult. So it depends on every kid's a little bit different and with their personality and
right.
how comfortable and confident that they feel.
And, you know, and I think the school has more resources today than they did back in my day, that's for sure, to handle some of these issues. And I know there's great things happening here in Berks County with the Berks County Anti-Bullying Task Force. And our friend Chick Lee, that we all know and love, is very much at the head of that. And I applaud him and I applaud everyone, Pam Gockley from the Camel Project, John, yourself, and everyone. There's so many people to name. But it's a great, great operation. It's a nonprofit status where everyone's being brought together to talk about the bullying concerns here in Berks County and past Berks. We're all working together to help prevent people from becoming a bully and, of course, from bullying others. And we want kids to know that there is help. There is a way to handle this and deal with it. And the most often I try to explain to students is, you know, a bully is like a battery. And I often tell them, if you don't energize and recharge that battery, what's going to happen? It's going to slowly stop working and stop. Well, don't energize the bully. Don't respond to the bully. Don't counter the bully. Walk away and report. So I think if our parents take that advice and talk to their students and their children at home, I think we'll all be much better off with that bullying problem being resolved in that way. So it's all about let's keeping the children safe. John, any closing tips or remarks for our parents out there?
No, I just say, I think you said it best earlier, Dave. I think if the parents make it a commitment to go to back to school night, to go to the students' conferences, communicate with the teachers as often as needed. You know, in today's age with social media, you have access to the teachers through email, which we didn't have when we were growing
right.
up. So
yes.
There's no excuse to just sit at home and take 30 seconds. Hey, could you give me a call? I have some questions for you. And the communication piece, I think, is critical, not only for student safety, their academic, but for the sanity of a lot of our parents.
Oh, absolutely. And it's going to be a positive experience at school. We want our students to come home excited about school. We want them to learn and absorb the information, of course. And our goal is that everyone gets to and from school safely. And that's what today's about. And that's what we're here on the show. And John, I'll tell you, you've been a wealth of knowledge and your experience is outstanding. 40 years in education. You know, I applaud you and congratulations on your retirement, John. That's great.
Thanks very much, Dave, and thanks for having me.
And thank you for staying in the game, being part of the bullying task force. I think that's a great thing, and we're very honored to have you with us today. So, folks, again, our final point is talk with the kids. Share information, give them the guidance that they need, and reinforce those positive tips with your child at home, your grandchild, your niece, your nephew. Any of these little guys that are going back to school this year, we want them to get there and get home safely. So I want to thank everyone for tuning in to Safer Neighborhoods for Stronger Communities. And as always, want to thank our host who came on to promote the show. And that's, of course, is the Michael Metzler Award was our sponsor through Crime Alert Berks County. I'm Dave Shallcross, and we'll see you next time. Thank you.